We would also like to thank the Citrus Valley Association of Realtors for hosting, allowing us to host this event here, so we're very grateful for that. And at this point, I would like to introduce Cliff Hamlow, who is part of the Legislative Action Committee for the City of Glendora and the Chamber of Commerce. Thank you.
Thank you, Ara. This is a chamber event. We have sponsored Get to Know Our Candidates, and we had more candidates, and now we're down to the final two for each of these congressional districts. And so we are pleased to have Grace Napolitano, who is current congresswoman. Actually, it's partially a new district and partially an old district, right? 85% new, okay. And David Miller, who will be running as well. We have a few rules. We ask you to hold your applause. We'll give them a big hand at the end. There are people collecting cards, and if you have a question, write that question. It'll go back to a group of screeners picking up the collecting Gene Morrell of Certified Automotive Specialist, and he'll collect your card, and then we have the screeners of RF Taj, our chamber president, represents known sports clips, and Bob Kuhn, who's Three Valleys Water board member. Our timekeepers are Marilyn Grinsdale from Citrus College and Fawn Imboden from America's Christian Credit Union, and we appreciate your doing that, and they'll hold up little signs for you, try to keep you on target. We'll have a 3-minute opening statement, and then the questions will be 90-second responses from each candidate to each of the questions, and then they'll have 3-minute closing session. I think that's all of the ground rules to keep us going. So we'll open the, we'll have Congresswoman Napolitano open our meeting with her 3-minute opening.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for the invitation to be here once more. My candidacy, as you well know, and I said it before, I'm a carpetbagger, simply because I'm in the 38th Congressional District, have represented for the last 14 years. We are trying to still develop more jobs, whether it's through the authorization of the transportation TLU bills, trying to get the NEPA-CEQA issue involved, solved with the state, to where our state laws are better than the federal, that they're acceptable by federal agencies. It will save business, it will save cities much money. We have the major priority of LA County is TIFIA, the Transportation Infrastructure Finance Innovation Act. And we're trying to help the county so that we have better transportation. I still believe we need to have more public transit. And I don't mean buses, I mean the metros, to move people and get more cars off the road. I was able to pass an amendment to the Positive Train Control that will help prevent railroad accidents, and that is because of the terrible tragedy up in Chatsworth a couple years back. That's hopefully going to stay in. It will save lives. With the Alameda Corridor for the building of great separations between East LA and all the way down to probably the end of the Los Angeles County. We're getting additional funding to have those. We hope the railroad will continue to put more money into them, but somehow they only put in 3%, which is just the drop in the bucket. We're hopefully going to continue to help the CNG buses, the compressed natural gas for Foothill Transit, the extension of the Gold Line. We are still pushing to be able to get that more funding, so it'll go all the way down to the Inland Empire, down to further down in the other county. Forgive me, I'm in a hurry here. Water, we're still fighting for more quality water, to save water, to clean it, to ensure that we have good potable water, and that we don't have a north versus south water fight. The St. Gregory Basin cleanup, we have no more funding coming to it, so that's going to be another battle we're going to have in Washington, D.C. to clean that San Gabriel Aquifer. continue to put the funding or request funding for the desalination and mental health for our veterans, for our students, for our seniors. We need to ensure that we continue to make that a priority and continue to destigmatize it. Veterans are important. We are now in a big fight to be able to ensure that it would happen. And I certainly am glad I'm here.
Thank you to the Citrus Valley, and thank you to the Chamber of Commerce for having us here. Let me tell you a little bit of the reason I'm here. I've got four children, my oldest being 28 and my youngest being 16 years of age. I am not a career politician, nor do I have a desire to be a career politician. I think that's the problem, is we've had people go into Congress for many, many years, and we flipped the whole idea of what our nation is supposed to be founded and built upon. And so the reason I'm running is because I'm a small business owner, and I've had to live under the rules that have been passed for the last 40, 50, 60 years by the politically elite ruling class. And I had an epiphany, a moment in 2008 as my business began to crash. And I decided I couldn't find any leaders. So I had to decide to stand up and become a leader. The only reason our nation is in its state that it's in is we, the citizens, have backed out of the equation. And we've allowed special interests, whether it be on the right or the left, to decide what's best for this country. Well, I've had enough of big government spending, big government debt. I've had enough of the government coming down into my life and telling me what to do. Most of you know me in here, and my platform is the United States Constitution. Article 1, Section 8 states there's 17 areas in which the federal government is allowed to govern. It's like a homeowners association. There's 50 states, and we've said to the federal government, you handle security, you handle federal roads, you handle certain things, but leave the rest to us. We've got 10 amendments to the Constitution. Two of them, 20% of them say, leave me alone. Stay out of my life. Leave the states to themselves and the people to themselves as well. So the question isn't really as much about what I believe and what I can do when I get to Congress. The question really is, what is our citizens gonna do? What is our community gonna decide? Because guess who's been sending these career politicians to Congress every 2 years? They don't get there on their own. It's been you and I that have been sending them to Congress every 2 years. So it's incumbent upon us to decide that we're gonna start making the rules. The first things we need to start doing is changing the understanding that Congress people are supposed to go there to do this, protect our life, our liberty, and our property from being taken away by somebody else. They think their job is to go take it from somebody else so they can give it to their friends and get reelected. I'm here because I want to change this nation. I don't want to become a career politician, and I'm asking for your vote. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to hold the applause. We'll do that at the end. First question's to you, David, and we'll alternate. You'll start, then Grace will respond, and then the next question will be hers. What should the role of the federal government be when it comes to education?
Education is not in the Constitution, and here's what I tell people. If you can find the role that you're asking me to have the government do in this document, I will do it. And here's the reason why. You're hiring me for a job which I am legally bound to do. You're hiring me as a congressman. I can only do what I've been allowed to do or given the authority I've been given by the people. It's in this document, Article 1, Section 8. Everybody in this room should know this. And if they do not know this document, that's part of the reason we're having our problem. So I implore you, I have constitutions in the back, page 6, Article 1, Section 8. Read it. Know the role of your government. That's the only way you're going to hold me or anybody else who's in Congress accountable. Thank you.
Yes, my mother was a teacher, so I held teachers in greatest esteem, and we need to ensure that we provide as much education to all of our children as much as they're capable of taking. Without an educated workforce or a community, we do not have the ability to prosper as well as we can. We are importing all kinds of workers, and we need to change that. We need to be able to ensure that we provide the basic tools for all our children. What government can do is ensure the money goes where it is needed and not spent on programs that have been obsolete. We need some hawks out in the community to tell us what's not working so that we can propose the changes to the appropriate people in Congress to make sure they take it into consideration when they're making the laws that govern all of us. We have many faults. We've fallen behind. We need to ensure that we continue to provide affordable education, especially as regards higher ed and engineering and all the faces that we are holding dear, but it's so expensive for youngsters to be able to access that education. But we need to also ensure that we pay our teachers well and that we have the ability to ensure that we support the teachers and support our children in school. Thank you.
Okay, Congresswoman, the next question. Should the federal government be managing our health care system?
I believe that's an easy one. We do not have health care for many individuals. They fall through the cracks. It's unaffordable. Insurance companies have really, they cherry-picked, and when I was in the State Assembly, we found that very prevalent, so that people who had long-standing illnesses would not be able to get the coverage, or they were halted in their ability to get full coverage. And I think it's long overdue, but understand that the bill that was passed is not the final. We need input from you, the residents, of where we need to tweak it, because if we don't, then we have responsibility to ensure that its coverage is well placed for the people that need it and affordable for those, and that the insurance companies are held accountable to be able to provide that health care, whether it's in parity in mental health, whether it's pre-existing conditions, all those things that people, that they lose their whole life savings in their homes and their businesses because they have to pay for this health care. So in essence, it is up to all of us to ensure that we have input into what needs to be done. And if you don't tell us, I don't know, and neither will anybody else.
See, that's exactly where the problem lies, is we have a differing worldview, and here's my worldview. My worldview is that it's not the responsibility of the federal government to be involved in healthcare. You know, there's 535 people in our Congress, and they think that somehow they're smarter than 350 million people who make decisions. Our government is the one who's created the problems. They say that anybody who walks into a medical emergency room for any reason can get health coverage at $500 per visit. Why is it that expensive? Because the government got involved. The government got involved and said, you can't have state insurance carriers cover cross state lines. So they think that they're so smart because we have an elite ruling class of people over us. We need to break those chains of the elite government and decide that, guess what? I can handle my own medical insurance. I can handle my own medical care. What did they do before 1950 or 1940? Were people lying in the streets because they weren't getting coverage? No. The community came together and they helped one another. I believe we have a responsibility as individual citizens to care for one another, not as a state through forced taxation.
Okay, David, this is your question. As a candidate, what plan do you have to support our men and women in uniform after they come back home? And the second part of that question is the VA must be reformed, agree or disagree?
Well, as I said in this document, that is one area that we have given authority to the federal government over, which is our national defense. So we have a responsibility to defend our nation against foreign and domestic enemies. That is my responsibility as a congressman. I will uphold that with no exceptions, that we are going to defend our nation. Now, I've read the 2013 Department of Defense request. There are billions of dollars that we've decided as a nation we're going to send to Afghanistan. But yet there's not enough money in the budget to take care of the citizens who have went to fight for us. It's unconscionable. We have our priorities messed up, and if we don't change our priorities, again, it's on us. So that's why I need you to send me to Congress.
That's a very critical question for a lot of our areas, because we have hundreds of thousands of men and women coming home and finding themselves in a quandary because they've lost their homes, their business, their families even, and their health. It is our responsibility. We put them in harm's way. And there has been the VA needs to be reformed. And I can tell you that the two VA directors from Westwood and Long Beach have met with us and with veterans who have longstanding claims to be able to ensure that those are taken care of. We need to up their retirement so that they can take care of themselves when they are ill. There's PTSD and TBI, traumatic brain injury issues that are going to be with us for many generations, and we have not been alert enough to take care of those. They paid with their blood, they paid with their sacrifice, and lost much of what they had and held dear. We need to ensure that they get back into society, that we provide them with education, provide the homeless with assistance, and be able to provide mental health service delivery to those that need it, and they will need it.
Okay, Congresswoman, this is your question, and I believe it comes from this young man right here. What does my generation have to look forward to in the future?
Well, hopefully, my young man, that it will be brighter than it was when I came into this great country of ours. That you have better chances of education, you have better opportunities to learn and travel the world and see what is out there as competitive as it can be for you, but you must get educated. And you have to focus on being able to learn from your adult friends that have gone on to higher education, that there are things you can do to prepare yourself. Whatever you do, it's gotta be from your heart, because that's what's going to make your life much better. And you will be able to be successful in whatever you are. And I'm sure your parents are going to guide you through that lovingly. And there's others who are willing to help. So keep in touch with all of us. And if you're old enough, you can come and intern in one of our offices, and we'll be glad to show you the other side of it. Good luck to you, sir.
Well, that question is a question for each and every one of us in the audience. What are we going to leave for our kids? That truly is the reason I'm here. My girls and all of their friends are going to be left with debt and inflation and all the terrible things that we have coming unless we decide that we're going to make a change. Real quickly, I'll tell you a story. Some of you may have heard it because I've told it before. When I got out of high school in 1981, I was making $425 a week as a junior estimator. Gasoline was a little over $1.20 a gallon. Rent on an apartment was about $600-$800 a month. Today, my daughters and their friends can't find work at $425 a week, and gasoline is $4.25 a gallon. We have created the problem we're in, and unless we do something about it, you're going to be overtaxed. So I hope you join us, and I thank you for coming and participating.
David, as this forum is being held at the Citrus Valley Association of Realtors, what are your solutions for the many families struggling to make their mortgage payments with the declining market values?
Well, again, the only thing that I can do is change the way that things are done up in Washington, D.C. I'm a small business owner, and I've talked to a lot of small business owners, and every time they turn around, they've got some new regulation either coming down from the federal government or from the state government. So I'll speak federally. My job is to get the federal government out of your pocket and off your back and out of your business. If that occurs and we reduce the taxation and all the onerous regulation, then we'll be able to start hiring people again. I know businesses. I talked to a gal the other day. She said she has 75 employees. When Obamacare comes into effect, she's either going to lay off a number of employees to get below the line, or she's going to split her company into two different companies. Now, which means she's going to have to do more paperwork, more taxes, more. So we're always sitting here trying to get through this maze of these wise 535 people who are sitting up in D.C. I'm going up there and going to be able to represent you because I've had to live under these rules. And I know what they're like and what they're about. And so I'm going to go there to represent the common man.
That is one of the biggest issues we have in California is the houses that are up for sale, empty, being utilized for drugs and for other unsavory uses. Working with the communities, with the city officials, with the county officials, and finding out how we can keep those values up until the market starts climbing again. We can and we must do everything we can to protect our home values. And I understand there's been federal funds to the state to come down and assist those who are underwater. You need to be able to tap into those resources and ask what programs are out there, whether it's from the realtors or from the state or the county folks, your elected officials, because there are some programs that have been set to help people stay in their homes until the economy begins to flourish a little better and they can afford to be able to continue making their mortgage payments. It's a sad thing that many people were bilked. They were sold homes they couldn't pay for. And in a sense, I blame a lot of the Wall Street and the industry. So we need to be vigilant. And yes, the government had to step in and start putting a stop to some of those onerous ways of doing business. And it's hurt our people, it's hurt our economy, it's hurt our communities, and we must be vigilant to that. Thank you.
Okay, in relationship, this is probably a follow-up to a certain extent. Where do you stand on keeping the mortgage deduction for our primary home, second home, and investment properties? And Grace, this would be yours, I believe.
Would you repeat the question?
Sure. Where do you stand on keeping the mortgage deduction for our property, primary home, second home, and investments?
Well, that's a no-brainer. That's about the only thing people have to be able to take from their income taxes, their mortgage interest payments. Certainly, it is essential that we continue to do that. There have been rumors in some of the circles in Washington, D.C., that they want to take that away, and we're thoroughly fighting it because that's what keeps us in the middle class and some others that are able to stay, especially seniors that can stay in their residences. So it is important, and we certainly will continue to advocate that not be taken away from the homeowners. That builds up the equity. That's what helps us become stable in our communities. That's what gives you credit to be able to purchase things that you need or borrow money to send your kids to college, etc. So that investment has to be protected, and those taxes that you get a write-off on is the only thing we have anymore.
Well, I would suggest that we take an entire look at the tax code, entire look at the size of the federal government. We spend $3.2 trillion annually on a bloated government that wants to do everything for us. Whether we get this deduction or that deduction, I don't know that it's really that relevant. I actually think it's kind of wrong for somebody else far away to try to manipulate us to do certain things. I mean, I can tell you, I've made some bad business decisions based around the tax code, and I've lost plenty of money because of that. I believe that we are supposed to be free citizens to choose the course of which we want in our life. If you want to buy a home, buy a home. If you don't want to buy a home, don't buy a home. Lower my taxes, let me keep my money, don't try to manipulate the way I'm going to live my life. We started this nation with certain values and principles that made us great. And yet now, 50, 60 years later, we want to return to the same values that England had, which was the king's going to tell us how to do it. So again, it's your choice. Do you want a king or do you want to be free?
Okay, next question is yours, David. The National Park Service, along with the Sierra Club and Wilderness Society, want to create a national recreation area designation for our local San Gabriel Mountains. That would take away our local control of our natural resources and watersheds. Are you supportive of this?
I'm sorry, can you read the title again real quick? What was the title of that?
The National Park Service, along with the Sierra Club and Wilderness
Society. No, the name of what they're trying to call it.
National Recreation Area Designation for our local San Gabriel Mountains.
Well, the way it's written, boy, I'm for that. Can you imagine? Who would be against National Recreation? Again, here we go again, right? These guys are geniuses up there. They want to decide that they're going to take away our mountains and decide what we can or can't do. Well, then they're going to start charging us to go up to the river and walk around, and they're going to charge us to park fees, and they're going to take control of it from a far, far land away. Okay? Guys, when is it going to stop? When are we going to get angry enough and say, hey, get your hands off our stuff? We're big grown-ups. We can figure it out. Well, wait. We live in the state of California. Maybe the state of California can't figure it out. But you and I can figure it out. So, you know, we'll clean out the state house as well. But the thing is we have stood on the outside so long that it's almost as though the language has changed, the whole culture, everything. We're confused. We're speaking different languages. I'm going to keep going back to this same idea. Do we want local control of our lives? Do we want the schools to be locally controlled or the federal government to take the money, wash it, take their piece, and send it back to us? That's the question that we're going to answer in the 32nd Congressional District this time. And I hope you answer it correctly.
Thank you. San Gabriel Mountains, a lot of the mountain areas around here are federally owned already. Now, I had not heard anything about the Park Service and Sierra Mountains trying to convert it into the National Recreation Area designation for San Gabriel Mountains. I would have some trepidation about delving into that without knowing the full content. Because watersheds, that's where the water agencies are able to control some of the water that comes in to delivery to you. So that in itself could deal to some questions about its ability to raise water rates. Think about it, that the upkeep. Many of the cities have been given the parks over by the county because they could not upkeep them, so the cities are now doing the parks. Is this the same thing you're going to deal with? We don't know. We need more, and we need to ask questions, and we need to hold people accountable. The federal can't come in and just do something because they want to. So we need to be able to be alert as to what it really means, and what is it going to cost the taxpayer, and how much of that is going to impact the folks that are within the area of the San Gabriel Mountains. So those are questions that are up, and I certainly would want to keep an ear to the ground and ensure that we have better information dissemination so that everybody knows what goes on.
Okay, Congresswoman, this is a moderator question. I watch your voting record very carefully, and I know that you have been extremely supportive of items that locally affect us, water, transportation, those types of things. But it appears to me, you have a record, I'm going to ask David the same thing, that from there on, you're pretty much a party line person. And so my question really is, how are we going to get Congress to talk to each other and drop the party line so that we can get answers to the questions?
That's $1 million question.
I know it is.
I can tell you I was subcommittee chair of Water and Power, and as I was chair, I passed more Republican bills than I did Democrat bills, and I'm a Democrat. And the reason is I felt that water has no politics. It needs to happen to be able to better the ability of water delivery. That said, I work closely with David Dreyer. I've worked across the line because we need to do it. Now, I tried to get a California delegation going. I couldn't get the Republicans to come and sit with us. So the effort is there, and it depends, I guess, on people understanding that we need to become representatives, not politicians. And I consider myself, I'm a high school grad, I don't have degrees, I've worked all my life, I'm 75. Guys, this is who I am. I'm not going to change. I bring services to my district, and I say that openly because I've Spanish did it for the last 14 years. Now, whatever everybody else says or thinks, that's fine. We stand on a record, not here yet, hopefully, but understand that we try, and if I can't get it done, I'm not a policy wonk. I get it done by working with people who can get it done, by adding amendments, by doing things into bills that will help us bring things down here. That's why we've been successful.
Now, David, you don't have a record.
Not that you know
of. We can't, well, not that's public right now, at least. So how are you going, if you're going to go to Washington, D.C., how are you going to cross that aisle and get things done that are that the American people want done?
Well, send me to Congress, and here's why I think you should send me to Congress. Because my decisions are going to be based upon certain principles. And those principles are not relevant to a political party. Those principles are relevant to the founding document of our nation, which again, legally, is what I'm allowed to govern in. For anybody who may not know, I ran as an independent in 2010 for Congress. I have many, many, many Democrats who are supporting me because I talk first and foremost about the ideas before we start talking about what party you're from. Because if we don't get over this party thing, we're just tearing ourselves up down here. And this party thing is all done in D.C. They want us to keep saying, oh, you're a Democrat, you're a Republican, let's not have conversations. I actually agree with Grace in this. I got a hold of some of the Democrats. I actually spoke to the previous Democrat candidate and was talking about locally starting a discussion between the assembly district for the Democrats and the assembly district for the Republicans, because there's no reason why we shouldn't have conversations and stop looking at each other as the enemy. So send me there, but I will never, ever break the principles of liberty.
All right, this question is for you. David, what are your thoughts on resolving the problem of illegal immigration?
Well, that's probably one of the hardest questions to ask in a forum because it is so, so complex. But I will again start on a principle. And the principle is this. Are we a nation of laws? Yes or no? We have to answer that question. And if we're decided that we're a nation of laws, and we're a nation which is allowed to govern ourselves and decide who comes and goes out of our borders, then we have to first and foremost start with the principle of enforcing the existing laws on the books. We don't need any new laws. But in order to take the fact that we've got 30 plus years of people in government, especially Congress, who have left the borders wide open, unchecked, the reasons are irrelevant, but they've done it. So we now have a huge undocumented population of people in our nation, which we have to solve. Now, how we're going to solve that, again, is a complex question. If anybody wants to talk to me afterwards, you can. But understand this, my will always come down on the side of the principle of we are a nation of laws, and first and foremost, we need to enforce the laws of this nation. And we need to decide how many people come and go in our country. If we can have 2,000 people, for example, live in Glendora, because that's all the water we can afford, if we allow 4,000 people, nobody gets water. And so we have to be responsible as a nation with our immigration policy.
I've dealt with immigration since I was on city council and through the state assembly and also for the last 14 years. It's an issue that is really a big hunk of weight on the shoulders of a lot of people. This is a nation of immigrants. It's built by immigrants. California has prospered because of that immigrant population, and I don't care where it comes from, because let me tell you, there's as many immigrants from other countries as there are from south of the border. And we understand that without those immigrants, we wouldn't have the prices for food, clothing, everything else that you can think of, because they do it cheap. Now, we need it, the agriculture needs it, but somehow the immigration system has not been able to be able to track people who overstay their visas. We need to ensure that we get the felons out of here, lawbreakers that do not abide by our laws. But we have families who own businesses in this country that, for whatever reason, are now undocumented, or, if you will, illegal. And we need to ensure that we treat everybody with the same dignity. We are a nation of values, family values. And for that, I think we need to ensure that all of us look at that issue very thoroughly and that we don't hit ourselves because we're trying to deport everybody that just looks a certain way. Thank you.
Okay. It's yours now, I believe. What is your plan? What is a good plan to pay off our nation's $16 trillion debt? How can it be accomplished?
Well, start off with cutting government. I'm for that. Cutting a lot of the services that we rendered that, for some reason, there's been a lot of abuse and fraud, et cetera, and we've not gone after the fraudulent use of not only Medicare, Social Security, you name it. Start there first and be able to have every agency make a cut of 10 or 15%. We did it at the state level when I was there. It works. But we also need to understand that we do need services for our community. How do we help is we're looking for more opportunities to export, to build businesses, to build the jobs, to build our economy. It's all relevant. And if we don't start educating our youngsters to be able to compete and do the jobs that will be coming up, whether it's green technology, whether it's aerospace or other technology, then we are not helping ourselves. So. It is a long way to go. We are getting out of it slowly but surely, and this was predicted. And we hope that in the next decade that our children, especially this young man, will not have that $1 trillion debt on their shoulders. I have two great-grandchildren. I don't want it on theirs either. So we must all work together to ensure that we have the capability to rein in government, rein in our expenditures, and work with our local officials to make better use of those things that we do need. Because we do need services, especially for seniors and some of the youngsters in school education and things that are important for small business. Thank you.
Well, that's, again, one of those very difficult questions. Imagine the number, $16 trillion. You know, I remember growing up, I don't remember when I heard the first time the word trillion. And now we have $1.3 trillion deficits every single year for the last 3 years. So the answer to the question of how we're going to reduce the debt is we have to change the way that we function and operate. You know, what's real interesting is if somebody charges on my credit card out of state, my credit card company makes a phone call to my cell phone and says, hey, are you in Texas? I said, no, I'm not in Texas. I'm standing here in California. Well, we just got a charge on your credit card. Oh, okay. Well, can you cancel the card and send me a new one? See, again, it's what do we want? The government, when we were going through the difficult financial times, and also in 9/11, they passed bills like that. Minutes they solved stuff, days at a time. They passed Obamacare, slammed it through in no time flat. Yet we sit here year after year and try to figure out how to cut 20% out of the budget. Are you kidding me? I'll bet you everybody in this room in the last 3 years has cut 20% out of their budget. I know mine's gone down at least 30 or 40% because my income is as well, so. We just got to get started.
Okay. Next question. What are your specific proposals to provide economic empowerment to the U.S. constituents of the 32nd Congressional District? That should be...
Economic empowerment. Again, we go back to be able to ensure that we have our strip malls, all our empty businesses working, that we have the ability to find markets abroad for our product. We've held one seminar. We're holding a second one for export, not for import, for export. Somehow we need to be able to produce more product to sell outside our countries, to other countries rather, because if we don't, we continue to have an imbalance with China and with the other countries. We are not, we can produce it, we have the technology, we have the manpower, we have all the ability to do that. Empower our businesses, empower the people, empower new, help new, and this is where government sometimes does step in, is programs to help entrepreneurs develop new products, new ideas to be able to make things easier, sell the product that is going to save us money or time. Look at the gasoline technology that has evolved, the telephone technology, and when you talk about NASA, we've been able to utilize a lot of the technology learned there for application to everyday use. We need to continue to work on that and be able to ensure that we use it, make it in America, built by Americans, and be able to sell it abroad.
Well, this is a personal issue for me, and I'll be honest with you. I'm a little confused by the question, and I'll tell you why I'm confused by the question. I get empowered every day by my hunger, by my children, them being hungry, by a mortgage I have to pay, by gasoline I have to put in the car. The spirit of America is in each and every one of us getting up every day and deciding that we're going to be a responsible citizen to go into the world and provide for our family, to be able to take care of our friends and our loved ones. That's our individual responsibility. So if you're asking me to go to Congress to do those things which you are required to do on your own, you're sending the wrong guy. What I'm gonna do is get the federal government out of your way so you can live your life according to the desires and aspirations and hopes and dreams of your life. Who am I to tell you how to live your life? I'm just another guy. So this is the conversation we have to have. We have to have this conversation. What is going to be the role of the federal government? That's the question we're going to be asking November 6th.
Okay, David, this is your question. What is your position on earmarks?
My position on earmarks is very simple again. Everybody pick up a constitution in the back of the room. If it is not on page 6 in Article 1, Section 8, don't ask me to do it. Now, I'm going to clarify something. There are a lot of things the federal government does today that are not constitutional. So the question has been asked of me in the past, well, what are you going to do, just unplug it? Are you just going to stop doing those unconstitutional things? Well, that's impossible. The entire society would implode, okay? So, what my proposal is that we take the Constitution and we place it on the wall before us, and we decide that that's our destination to freedom, that we are going to turn this aircraft carrier around and go towards freedom each and every day. So I will always vote to always reduce the role of the federal government in every area of our lives that is not constitutional.
Earmarks. Right now there aren't any. And they, as long as my colleagues are in Washington are against it, I guess there won't be. But those earmarks have helped build the overpasses, the great separations. They have helped the millions of dollars we brought in to be able to supply for the CNG buses, the compressed natural gas, to be able to do money for the water recycling projects that are so critical to be able to ensure that we have protection against drought cycles. Those are all earmarks. They call it pork. I had an editorial board look at all the earmarks that I brought in and say this is essential pork. It is for the community. It's no special interest. Those are all for cities, for entities that the university, we were able to get them over $5 million to be able to build two super high-speed tunnels so they can train the engineers and work for aerospace instead of importing our help. Those are earmarks that I'm proud of because we have to have some education for our students to be able to compete against the world. Yes, of course, sometimes it may be a little harsh for some people to realize, but where are they going to get the training if not in our own backyard at universities that are local? So to us, earmarks mean complying with the community's needs. What are the needs? And we ask every city, what are your priorities? And those become earmarks for us because they know where the money has to be spent.
Thank you. I think this is a statement and then a question. When unions started, they were to protect workers' rights. Now they seem to demand higher rates, retirement benefits, and so on. What can be done to allow unions to continue protecting workers, but at fair and affordable benefits?
Okay. Well, labor has established the middle class, and I can tell you because I've seen the growth of labor. I don't always agree with them. Because I think sometimes they get a little overreaching in many areas that we should have some other kind of mentality towards assisting the community, especially like teachers, the fire department, police departments, areas where they're critically needed. Labor has done a magnificent job in many areas, and I like I said, I differ with them in other areas, and I have no problem talking to them about it. I've had their support. I'm not a union person, I've never have been, but when you see what they've been able to accomplish for some of the working class, that they can own homes and have a car, send their kids to college because they have decent wages and health insurance, then you begin to understand what it really means. There are many areas that require a lot of scrutiny, and I think it's up to the individual organizations, whether it's the city or whether it's local folks, to be able to talk to not only labor organizers, and find out what they can do to be able to be better in tune with the community and the budgets that they have to deal with. So there's many other aspects to it. So I say keep tuned.
Simple answer is competition. See, competition is what makes me as a general contractor be honest. Because I can't walk into somebody's house and charge them $10,000 for a kitchen when there's three other guys who are going to do it for $7,500. It keeps me in check. I have to either become more efficient, I have to be better at my job, I have to find new ways of being able to get that price down to be able to compete. The problem with our government unions today is there's absolutely no competition. It's completely locked out. So I have an idea. I'm going to ask people to start an alternative union to all the unions. And when contract time comes up, we'll have two unions bidding against each other for the contract. So we'll solve the problem about where the big bad Republican is because we don't like unions. You can be a union all you want. It's just a collective group of people deciding that they want to govern a certain way in their contract negotiations. So I'm going to see if I can help start some free enterprise unions who are willing to collectively join together and help save our schools by not overcharging for stuff, to be able to take and make sure that those jobs that people are being paid to do are in check. Today, let me see anybody in this room go find a job for $250,000 a year. That's what superintendents make, in the range of $250,000 with their benefits and all the other stuff. So I'm just asking that we be responsible for the money that we've been handed by our citizens.
Okay, David, this is yours. What will you do to help those who don't have jobs and have given up the hunt for a job?
What will I do to help? I'm looking for work myself, actually. again, you know, we're back to that question. I tell you, I don't know how many, every day I get people sending stuff into my office saying, hey, we're with the American Motorcycle Association. What are you going to do for us in Congress? Really? What has the American Motorcycle Association got to do with the congressman? We have to realize that it is our responsibility to provide for our family and friends. And I can tell you this, I've had neighbors that are in trouble and having difficult times. It's my responsibility to go help my neighbor, not yours, unless you choose it freely. I can't go to your house and take your food and take your stuff to go help my neighbor. That's why we're in the state we're in. The thinking in this nation has changed somehow, that others are responsible for us. It isn't so. My grandfather came here from Italy. My grandmother came here from France. They came here with sixth grade educations over through Ellis Island. They built this country from coast to coast with the highways and the byways on a typical sixth or eighth grade education without this big government. I'm sure, no offense to whoever asked the question, working hard, you will eventually find that job. Just don't give up.
Well, we first of all, we need to start looking to be able to expand business. How do we do that? And again, we look to finding ability for getting businesses together to begin talking to each other about how they can help each other cut down costs. We've done forums, job fairs, especially for veterans. We're doing an export fair to be able to help business find more markets abroad. But fairs to be able to help businesses find the right employees. And sometimes those businesses want trained employees. So why not talk to the local community colleges to start getting training programs so those that are unemployed but out of the labor market can get some employment, some training, so they can are employable. Because there's some businesses looking for specific type of employees and they can't find them, they tell us. Well, maybe we're not helping them find the right employees by posting them on the city's reader boards or on markets or wherever we can to help people get back on their feet by having them being employed. The longer they stay unemployed, the harder it is. And certainly no person, no man, and no woman that I know of wants to be unemployed, being on the unemployment line. And I worked for unemployment for about 8 years, so I know the drill. I was with the State Department of Employment. So we need to ensure that however we can help by hosting fairs or passing the word if you know somebody has an opening or calling the media and having the media post employment opportunities in the media. And I agree with him, we need to be able to help each other.
Okay, we've come to the closing statements. And Grace, I believe you opened, so David, you will start our closing statement. 3 minutes.
Well, again, thank you for packing the room. It's showing us that there's a movement, that people are getting involved. You know, 3 years ago, I had never done anything political. I'd never contributed to a political candidate. I never walked a precinct, made a phone call, did any of that stuff, because I was out doing what I thought was right, which is building my business, take care of my family, providing a good home and a safe neighborhood. So I moved to the city of Glendora. I was doing what everybody in this room was trying to do, but something happened 3 years ago, and I woke up. You know, we're always looking to be the last one eaten by the alligator, okay? It's okay if they do that against their business. It's okay if they pass a law against that person. Just don't touch my stuff. Eventually, they'll get to your stuff. Taxes used to be for the wealthy and the million and billionaires. Now it keeps coming down lower, lower, lower. Every time you turn around, there's a new fee at every single level of government. If we don't do something now, today, and decide that, guess what? The principles we were given by our founders says this: government is instituted among men to protect and defend our rights to our life, our liberty, and our property. And when government ceases to do that, it is incumbent upon the citizens of the nation to alter or abolish that new form of government. Well, guess what, ladies and gentlemen? We're there. We have a new form of government. The politically elite ruling class, 30, 40, 50-year people going to Congress. Both parties have done this. So this isn't a party issue. This is a principle and a responsibility issue to our children. If we can go to bed at night and think that it's okay to lay $16 trillion worth of debt upon the heads of our kids so they will be taxed at the rate of 80% of their production, which means they're losing their life. That means 80% of their life will be spent working for somebody else. The state of California gets 87 cents back on every dollar that we send to the federal government, we're pretty bad negotiators up there in Congress. Send me there. I'll get every dime of yours back that I can. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, and I wish I could say that my one vote does change things in Congress, but unfortunately, as you pointed out, it is hard because there's so much partisanship in Washington, D.C. So then I opt to work directly with the agencies, and how do I do that is by finding out what the needs in my area are and then going to those directly to those agencies and asking for them to take a look at what is available. Do they have, I call it pockets of money, different portions that are programs that maybe we don't know about. And that's kind of hard to kind of define. You're right, 435 in Congress and 100 in the Senate. And it is so hard to try to work and be able to maintain. Because not only do you have to worry about Washington and the votes you have, and yes, we vote a certain way most of the time. I vote my district. I voted against President Clinton. I voted against Nancy Pelosi before. I have no problem with that when it is to the benefit of the district that I serve. And essentially, if you don't tell me what your feelings are, what you don't tell your electeds, I don't care whether it's a Congress or state or county or your local water officials too, you've got to get involved. You've got to tell people how it is that you feel change has to be affected. You are the ones who have to tell us. You elect us. The title is U.S. House of Representatives, not U.S. House of Politicians. And the same goes for any other elected office. Your taxes pay for the services. So what kind of services do you want? So if you don't want any kind of service, then you've got to start talking about it. But one area is not going to change the whole state, the whole U.S. We need to work together, and we need to start infusing for the benefit of those youngsters what the future is going to look like. That's my concern, as well as it should be to everybody else's, because it's something we're not leaving behind. To talk about water. We may not have enough potable water if we continue using it the rate we're using it. Or you talk about the watersheds, the clean water, the potential of more contamination from runoff from business or from agriculture, the fertilizers and the pesticides, or the air pollution that people are now have a highest incidence of asthma. What are we doing about that? And unless you tell us what's happening in your area, there's no way any of us, I don't care who it is able to rationalize and move forward to try to get some resolution to that. So it's working. The community is working together, and not just one city, but an area coming together and saying we've had enough, and this is what we need to do, and having somebody stand up for you wherever it is, whether it's city, state, county, or federal, and be able to move forward on that. So thank you so very much. You've been great. I appreciate it, and God bless.
Thank you. Let's give them a big hand. We appreciate it very, very much.